I have a question for you. A question that scared me for a long time. What would you do if Jesus walked in the room? Yeah, seriously, think about that. What would you do? What would you do? Jesus, God's only Son, the most understanding, caring, loving, forgiving friend you could ever have, self-sacrificing friend that you could ever have. What would you do? He is the one who has forgiven you 70 times, 7 times. He's your teacher. He's your provider. He is your good, good shepherd. What would you do? The one that you believed in without seeing appears in front of you, walks in the room. All doors are locked, all windows are shut. He walks in the room anyway. He confirms your faith. Any doubt that you had in the past, oh, it's gone now. He is in front of you. What would you do? Would you cry? Would you shout? Would you be able to speak at all? Would you know who he is? Do you know who he is now? Do you? If you don't, you're about to, which is the best thing. So in the Bible, it talks about different moments where people met with Jesus, sometimes for the first time, sometimes for, not just the second time, but the first time after he was risen again. First, we have the woman who washed Jesus' feet. In Luke 7, 37 through 38, go ahead and turn your Bibles there real quick. We're going to jump around in the beginning here, but it says, "And behold, a woman in the city who was a sinner, when she knew that Jesus sat at the table in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster flask of fragrant oil. And stood at his feet, behind him, weeping. And she began to wash his feet with her tears, and wiped them with the hair of her head. And she kissed his feet and anointed them with the fragrant oil." This woman cried. She washed his feet with her hair and her tears, because it's all she had and it's all she could give. The three wise men in Matthew 2, verse 11, says, "And when they had come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented gifts to him, gold, frankincense, and myrrh." These three wise, very wealthy men fell down and worshipped a baby. It's the first time they ever met Jesus. And then presented him with very luxurious gifts. In John 21, 7, it says, "Therefore, that disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter," I think we all know who that one is, "It is the Lord. Now when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on his outer garment, for he had removed it, and plunged into the sea." Peter swam across the sea just to be closer to Jesus after he had risen again. In Matthew 28, 9, it says, "And as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, 'Rejoice!' So they came and held him by the feet and worshipped him. Mary worshipped at his feet." And then in Luke 23, 39 through 43, "Then one of the criminals who were hanged blasphemed him, saying, 'If you are the Christ, save yourself and us.' But the other, answering, rebuked him, saying, 'Do you not even fear God, seeing you are under the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong.' And then he said to Jesus, 'Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom.' And Jesus said to him, 'Assuredly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise.'" A thief and a criminal declared that he was the Son of God with his dying breaths. That's what he did when he first met Jesus. These are just a few of the things that happened and were done in that time that Jesus was on the earth, but he's not done yet, which is a beautiful thing. Absolutely. Absolutely. I don't have the verse down here, but I just thought I'd mention, I thought it was really funny that Jesus, he came back 3 days later, right? He was crucified, buried, and resurrected 3 days later. He even told this to the disciples. He said, this is going to happen. Yet they were terrified when he walked in the room. Terrified, thinking the spirit, his spirit must be in front of us. It couldn't be Jesus. Only his spirit could be there. Put your fingers in the holes. Feel my side. It's me. Trust me. And then they rejoiced. But they were terrified. What would you do? Now, they had 3 days. They were mourning. We've had 2,000 years to prepare, to prep, to get ready. What would you do? Personally, I have a thought of what it would be like whenever Jesus were to walk in the rooms. Let's just imagine this, though, okay? Let's imagine this. Not that the second coming is here, not that any of this stuff is happening and all the prophecies are being fulfilled, but this is the moment of you sitting alone in your room or sitting in this church with a crowd around you, but he's in front of you. He's here for you. Angie, go ahead and pull up that video for me. This is how I imagine that we are going to react whenever we see Jesus.
I'm going on doing this time, I feel there's no one to see. This all or nothing really got away, driving me crazy. I need somebody to hear, somebody to know. Somebody to hide, somebody to hold. It's easy to say, but it's never the same. I guess I kinda like the way you numbed all the pain. Now the day bleeds into nightfall, and you're not here to get me through it all. I let my guard down, and then you pulled the rug. I was getting kinda used to being someone. I'm going under in this time, I fear there's no one to turn to. This all or nothing way of loving, go be sleeping without you.
Woo! Yeah. That little girl gets me every single time. She's like, Mommy! Oh, I love it. I love it. I love it. I love it. That's how I picture it, though. I picture us now, I picture it. That it's just an overwhelming excitement and joy. Talks about, in fact, I don't say it exactly, so I'm going to pull up the scripture because I didn't have it marked here, but yeah, here we go. And Mark 10, 14 through 15 even said, but when Jesus saw it, he was greatly displeased and said to them, let the little children come to me. And do not forbid them, for of such is the kingdom of God. Assuredly, I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will not enter the kingdom of God. Oh, man. Okay, so the reason I wanted to mention that is because I believe wholeheartedly that whenever we see Jesus, we're not going to be thinking of that thing we did last Tuesday, that sin we haven't forgiven ourselves for. We're just going to see him and like whenever that trumpet is sounded and all of our evil falls off. And our righteousness is what we're clothed in at that point. I feel like we're going to be like a child. We're going to have faith like a child. We're going to love like a child. We're going to forgive like a child. We're going to have that feeling like a child. Absolutely. Absolutely. That is the reaction I want to have when Jesus walks in the room. Crazy thing, though, is I used to be scared of it. Used to be scared of that moment. And I'm pretty sure I'm not the only one. Let's be honest here. Has anyone ever been afraid of, is he coming back yet? Is today the day? Oh no, I should have done that thing. Let me go to church. Let me repent. That was my thought process. If Jesus caught me with my hand in the metaphorical candy jar, the cookie jar, whatever it may be, it terrified me. I would have failed the one I decided to follow. And at least that was my thought. But you know what's funny? I focused on that so much. So much. But your focus is your future. What you focus on is your future. Where your heart is, there your treasure will be also. Race car drivers are taught that when they have lost control of their car and are about to hit the wall, to stare at the road, not the wall. To look at the wall is telling yourself to prepare for impact, prepare for this failure, this crash. It's all over. But when you look at the road, you are demonstrating a faith that your car will turn. Also, when you look at the road, your body naturally will just lean towards that road, naturally turning that steering wheel towards the road, subconsciously, not even thinking about it, but your focus is on the road, so your body will naturally move you to the road. Your focus is your future. Well, I don't want a future that has a focus on failure. Especially not one of failing Christ. So I stopped thinking about Jesus and his condemnation and how afraid I was of Jesus and coming back and judging me and everything else, which I will be judged one day. I will, but that's not what I want to focus on. Because if I focus on failing Jesus, there's a pretty good chance I'm going to be failing Jesus. So I started to think about God and his love. I thought about Jesus and how he knew me before I was born. He knew I would make mistakes. He knew I would stumble on my walk, and he knew I was not perfect. And you know how I know that? He died because of it. He died for mine and everyone else's sin. Jesus came down from heaven to be born a man, knowing he was going to be crucified for the sins of the world, and did it anyway. He knew what kind of man I am. He knows what kind of person you are. He knows what kind of person you are. He knows what kind of person you are. He knows the kind of person that we are, and he knows what we have done. And he doesn't care how bad we think it is. How unforgivable we think it is. He has already forgiven you. He just wants you to come home. He wants you to stop the foolishness and just come home. He still died for you. Now that's love. That's love. In John 15, 13, it says, "Greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for his friends." Well, that's what he did. You know why? You're his friend. He loves you. Absolutely. Completely and utterly, he loves you. Lay down his life for you. He wanted your salvation so much that he sacrificed himself. He knew that you would not be able to plead your own case, so he pleaded the blood. The only blood that can wash away our sins. The only perfect sacrifice. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. I want to be whole. I want to be whole. My wife and I were talking the other night, and she said, "You know, you make me whole. You're my other half. And whenever we're apart, I feel like a part of me is missing." I couldn't really relate with her, but I'm kidding. I love you. I'm kidding. Well, that's a fight when I get home. No, I'm kidding. Okay. I can relate. And I actually do feel the same way. I do. And when you marry someone, you grow together, and I'm pretty sure most of us here who have been married for a while can attest to this, but when you marry someone and grow together, you actually become like one flesh, and to be separated is like being torn apart. I think that Jesus feels the same way with us. Once he put his blood on the mercy seat in heaven and sealed our fate as joint heirs with him, we became like one flesh. That is why it pains him to see us suffer, because when we suffer, he suffers. That is why he loves us so much. We feel once we leave him, we can just never be forgiven, and then he does just that, so we can be one flesh again. Jesus told us this would happen, though. He told us we would be foolish at times and try to walk without wisdom, but that wouldn't stop his love. Now, that doesn't mean that we should leave and treat Jesus like a drive-through hospital for a quick pick-me-up before getting back on our road to destruction. Okay, now we gain wisdom and become a better person than we once were. We make sure that we heal who we were, not to be broken again, but just so we can move closer and closer and closer to glory. All right, so now we're going to get in the meat and potatoes of our scriptures here. We're going to open up our Bibles to Luke 15, 11 through 24. I searched the world, and it couldn't find me. Okay. I think everyone here, if we don't have any visitors, probably already knows the story of the prodigal son. But if you don't, say you're watching later and you don't know what prodigal means, prodigal is just lavish spending, okay? Spending the money that you probably don't even have, but you just want to look like you got it, okay? So it says here in verse 11, then he said, a certain man had two sons. This is a parable told by Jesus. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me. So he divided them his livelihood, verse 13. And now many days after, the younger son gathered all together, journeyed to a far country, and there wasted his possessions with prodigal living. But when he had spent all, there arose a severe famine in that land, and he began to be in want. Then he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into the fields to feed swine. And he would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the swine ate, and no one gave him anything. He was feeding pigs while he had nothing to feed himself. And he would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the swine ate, and no one gave him anything. Verse 17, but when he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father and will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Please make me like one of your hired servants. And he rose and he came to his father. But when he was still a great way off, remember this, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight and am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father didn't answer him. The father said to his servants, bring out the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet, and bring the fatted calf and here and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and he is found. And they began to be merry. The father had every right to tell his son that left, that he made his bed and now he has to lie in it. He could have turned him away easily, but instead he welcomed him back with love and praise. He celebrated that his son that was lost had now been found. All the while the prodigal son was ready for the condemnation, he wished for the lowest spot in the house just to be called a member of his father's house one more time, yet his father gave him so much more than that. Did he deserve it? No, absolutely not. He did not. But in the end, do we deserve it? No. No, we do not. Absolutely, unequivocally, we do not deserve the grace that we have received from God. Jesus made sure, though, that we did get it. We asked for that happy meal blessing, and he supersized that meal for us. Okay? Talking my language. Notice how he didn't make him walk in shame either. The Father didn't stand there and go, that's fine. Come on, right here. Okay. Who does that to their kid? Anybody like, no? No, come here. I know what you did. Don't stand back there. I need you right here. Stand right in front of me so I can talk to you, right? One time I've done it, okay? I'm not going to throw myself too far under the bus. But, wrong piece of paper. He ran to him. The Father ran to him. Jesus is running to you. Jesus sees you coming from afar off, and he is running to you. You want to be in his house, he wants you there more. You want to be a servant in his house, he wants you to be joint heirs with him. He does not care what pit you have been living in, what swine you have been feeding. He doesn't care what foolish decisions you have made. He doesn't care how long it took you to see the light. He is running to you. The prodigal son didn't even make it to his father's house before his father accepted him back. Remember that. The hardest part about confession is not admitting that you were wrong and taking that consequence that you get from your wrong actions that you made. That's not it. It's the shame. It's living with that shame. That thought process of going and walking up for asking for that forgiveness, that walk is way harder than the words that you will ever speak because you know you are walking in shame. Oh, the thought that says, just pass over me because I don't deserve forgiveness and nobody understands why I did what I did. Nobody ever will. Maybe I was wrong, but my justification will never be known because it's my perception, my perspective. Nobody will ever know because nobody sees my heart. No ordinary person can see your perspective, by the way. Nobody knows if you are saying sorry to get it over with, or if you are actually remorseful. Nobody sees things your way, except Jesus. Now, he doesn't tell you that your way is right, necessarily, but he sees it from your perspective as well. The Bible says, in the second half of 1 Samuel 16:7, for the Lord does not see as man sees, for man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. He knows why you did what you did. He does not condone your sin, but he knows why it happened in the first place. And he's wanting to forgive you, but you just have to come home. You just have to come home. I started getting over this fear of Jesus coming back when I stopped focusing on the fear. And my life has changed dramatically because of it. And when I became a father, and I speak about this all the time, but whenever I became a father, I talk about how I understand how God sees me a little bit more than I saw him before. I saw him as a parent, as a, I don't want to make you sad. I don't want to disappoint you. I don't want to do something wrong. But for some reason, I never just looked at him as love. Right? I never saw him as someone who understood, someone I couldn't just come to all the time. And now I do feel that way. And the reason I wanted to preach this message is because I want the people who still feel that you can't come to Jesus until you're clean. You can't come until you buy the suit. You can't come until you get your Bible signed by pastor. You can't come until whatever it may be, whatever your qualifier is. You don't need it. Jesus, if you were to walk in the room right now, I feel like he's an I know kind of statement person, God. He says, I know. Jesus, I know it was wrong to steal, but I was at the end of my rope. I know. Jesus, I'm sorry I picked up that bottle, but I thought it was the only thing that would take the pain away. I know. Jesus, I tried to quit using drugs, but it was so hard, and every single time I tried, someone else was handing me something else, and I know. Jesus, I failed you. I know. Jesus, I'm sorry. I started getting wrapped up in bad relationship after bad relationship after bad relationship. I didn't think I deserved any better. I know. I know. Now come here. You think you failed me, but honestly, everyone has fallen short. I understand that you feel that you need to succeed for me to see your value, but I saw it long before you ever tried. I love you through your failure, and luckily for you, I never fail. And with me, all things are possible, so stop trying to impress me and just accept my love. I know you stole. I don't condone it. But I know why you did it. I don't hate you for it. I know you have hurt people, but I have healed them. And I'm going to use you to heal people too. I used a murderer to bring people to me, and I can use a thief to do the same. I know you feel like you had no other option, but I am the only option, and I will take care of you just like I take care of everything and everyone I love. I know it's hard to put that bottle down. I know that you try time and time and time again, and every time you took a step away from it, you get knocked back twice as far. I know. But you don't need it anymore. I'm here. I know the drugs, they numb the pain of this world, but this world is passing away soon. And now you can rest easy knowing that I have overcame the world, and I'm going to teach you how to do the same thing. I know they hurt you when you were younger, and I'm sorry. Even though you experienced such evil, you are still searching for love. But your search is over. You have been looking for someone who will treat you right, not hurt you or leave you, someone who understands your worth. I know your worth. I paid for it in full, and it cost me my life, and I would do it again if only for you. One day, it won't be if, but when. Jesus is going to walk into your room. One day, he is going to take us home. And one day, all of these struggles will cease, and we'll have an eternity of glory. But until that day, remember this, he is with you. He is here. He lives inside of you. He's in your heart. He is in this room. If you have asked Jesus to forgive you of your sins and to come into your heart, he is already in the room. And if you haven't accepted him as your personal Lord and Savior, I welcome you to do it. I do. And guess what? There's no special words or actions that you need to do. If you believe that he is the Son of God and that he died on the cross for your sins, was resurrected from death 3 days later, and is coming back for us one day. If you proclaim him as the Son of God, just tell Jesus you are sorry for your sins and ask him to come into your heart and your life. That's it. There's no mile you have to run or cross you have to build or anything. Just accept him as your personal Lord and Savior. All right. So we're going to be closing out our sermon today, but we're going to do a little bit different. There's a video that I want to play here in just a little bit. We're going to turn down the lights a little bit. We're going to play this video. But before we do, I want everyone to know that I want you to do what I'm about to tell you without fear of judgment, without ridicule, without anything else. But I want you to praise, and I want you to pray, and I want you to think. I don't care if you have to get up. I don't care if you have to go sit in a corner, if you have to move around. I don't care if you have to be by yourself or with family. I don't care what you need to do to put yourself in that presence where you are accepting what the Lord is telling you, but do what you need to. Stand at your seat, pray at your seat, kneel down, whatever it may be. But ask the question, What would you do if Jesus walked in the room? Angie, you can go ahead and start playing that video. Just pray and think about that question. What would you do if he walked in the room? You don't have to be ready right now. You just have to be willing to accept him. What would you do?
What would you do if he walked into the room? What would you do if he walked into the room? What would you say if he walked into the room? How would you praise if he walked into the room? How would you shout if he walked into the room? How would you shout if he walked into How will you sing to him? He's here at. How will you shout to him? Say, he's here at. How will you worship him? He's here at. How will you bow before him? He's here at. Jehovah Shammah. He's here at. A very present help. He's here at. In the time of trouble. King is in the room. Your healer's in the room. Your savior's in the room. Your provider's in the room. Your redeemer's in the room. Your champion's in the room. He's in this room. So what will you do? Jesus Christ, the King above all kings. Jesus Christ, the King above all kings.
Oh, Jesus, we love you so much. We praise your name. Oh, just the thought of you walking in the room, God. Woo! Oh, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Lord. Oh. Ooh. Thank you, God. Thank you for being in this room. Thank you for being in our hearts, God. Thank you for being. Thank you for being. Who you are, our provider, our healer, our savior, our champion, our protector. God, we love you. We thank you for your son and all that he has done for this world and that he is continuing to do. Help us lead people to you every day. So that way they can have the healing and the protection and the glory that you want to share with all of us, God, as joint heirs in heaven. We love you. We praise your name. We ask for all these things in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, amen.